Hello, everybody. I am Drew Duncan. Here's a check him out live on the program Fired Up. Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram is all at Drew Duncan Radio. I am wherever you're listening to podcasts. Let me tell you, advice to play Fired Up by Drew Duncan on iTunes, iHeart, Google, Spreaker, Deezer, wherever you're listening. I am there. I am brought to you in part by Block 50 Global Radio. Block 50 Global Radio is online 24/7 at zenofm.com/Block50. Global Radio. Plenty to get to today. Obviously, we're going to be talking about the 49ers and Giants preview tonight. We're going to be talking about Justin Fields and his comments. I think a lot of that is being overblown. Of course, Justin Fields is the new finger pointing person, whatever you want to call it, the new scapegoat in Chicago. We're going to be talking about Eric Bieniemy. I just don't understand how this man is not a head coach. We're going to be talking about Colorado at Oregon, Ohio State, Notre Dame, UCLA, Utah. Let's get down to brass tacks. The 49ers, the Giants. First of all, it is official. No Saquon Barkley this Saturday after their head football coach was like, hey, he heals quick. I guess he's Wolverine now, whatever. Look, one of the things that I've talked about is how are the New York Giants going to really look without Saquon Barkley? You know, there's this whole thing right now with the NFLPA. They're under a cease and desist momentarily from the NFL. And the whole reason behind that is they are telling people to go ahead and exaggerate injuries, particularly running backs, in order to try and gain leverage. One of the things that I've talked about already is, to me, that is high risk, high reward. Because if you're going to exaggerate an injury and say it's worse than it is, understand that if they start playing good without you, that's going to be bad news. Now, understandably, Saquon's already got his money, but we all know how the NFL works, right? I think Saquon is really injured for anybody out there worrying about it. The point of what I'm saying is they don't want to let you go when they need or want you for whatever reason. But, man, they're quick to trade you or whatever they got to do, pay somebody for you to be there, whatever the case may be, if they feel like they're going to be better off without you. I mean, does anybody really say to themselves that they're impressed with the Giants with that comeback win over the Arizona Cardinals? I understand they were down by a lot, okay? And I know it's the NFL. But it's also the NFL, and a game is never really over, especially at halftime. I mean, obviously, let's take a look at the Denver and Washington. Obviously, we'll get into Washington a little bit later on here when we talk about Eric Bieniemy. But what I'm telling you is you look at that situation, a game is never over. John Elway, Tom Brady, Peyton Manning, these are all people who are perfect examples of it is never over until it's over. Right? So the reality of the situation is, when you look at the Giants, do you think they're really going to be any better without Saquon? One of the arguments that I have posed over the last couple of months with this whole running back thing and everything going on, when you think about the Giants, do you think about Danny Dimes or do you think about Saquon Barkley? And let's be honest, 99% of us, especially those of us that are not Giants fans, are definitely thinking about Saquon being the true leader of that football team. He had two touchdowns in that comeback against Arizona. He is the factor with the G-men. And I don't think it could be overstated, if I'm being perfectly frank. Of course, the antithesis is, you know, the 49ers, to me, they're probably the best team in football. I said it before Stephen A. did. It's too early to tell, but as of the moment, what's there not to like about Frisco, right? They've already been on the road twice in two different games. They beat the Rams. Matt Stafford, to me, was being Matt Stafford. They haven't been able to get the run game going with Cam Akers. Supposedly, the Rams are looking at trading him. At least that's what McVay says. They're at least entertaining offers, putting offers out there on the table. I'm not sold on Brock Purdy. I don't think he's a top-tier quarterback in the NFL. As that team goes, it goes with Christian McCaffrey. That's the reality of that situation offensively. And as long as McCaffrey stays who he is, which, you know, I don't see that really changing up at all. I mean, he might have a bad game here or there. But let's be honest, 17 games out of the year, you could pretty much count on McCaffrey and 14 of them is going to easily compile over 100 yards total offense and get, you know, a touchdown some way, somehow out of it, or at least put you in good position to score. I think they have one of the best defenses in all of the NFL. They look shaky against the Rams a few days ago, right? But obviously they buttoned up on the second half and they took care of business. Again, I could say Matthew Stafford was, to me, Matthew Stafford, but also let's give that credit to where it's due. And that is the defense stepped up. They made adjustments. They followed the coach's order. They executed. They put the clamps down on Stafford and company, and they handled business. I think we're going to find out really how bad the Giants are without Saquon Barkley. If you don't know by now, if you haven't figured it out, you're going to see it get exponentially worse. You can talk to me about the lack of time that Danny Dimes has had back there in that pocket all you want to. I'm not saying their offensive line is the best in the NFL, but I'm also saying I don't think it's the worst. I think it is an ill-prepared football team. I think there's not a lot of talent offensively, and I think that when you take Saquon out, he is your best chance to win to begin with, and if he's not there to distract the defense on fake handoffs and everything else, then the fact of the matter is you're done. I don't anticipate this game being close, if I'm being honest with you. I know that Thursday nights have been somewhat entertaining already to start this season, a complete 180 from last year. You could almost even call it a 360, really. But obviously, from a season ago, what we got, I mean, what was it, 6 or 7 weeks before a touchdown was finally scored on Thursday night? Got some horrible games last season on Thursday. I think this is going to be the first one of the year where we see a blowout. I would not be surprised if the 49ers won this thing going away. 30 points for them to win this game, to me, would be an understatement. I think at that point, they have probably underperformed, or they just got to a point where they took it easy on the Giants. Plus, I stand with Micah Parsons. I don't think it was a good look. And I think it sends the wrong message to your guy, Daniel Jones, to your football team, that when you're getting obliterated, you're just going to leave in all your starters, including your guy at quarterback that you just gave how many millions of dollars to over the offseason, right? That was a big part of the discussion with the New York Giants. Hey, we're giving all this money to Daniel Jones predicated upon one good season. What about Saquon? I know that Saquon has been injury prone in his career early on, but let's be honest, there's nobody else for them to go to right now. He's literally doing everything on that football team. He deserves everything that they were giving him, and then some, if I'm being honest with you. Without Saquon Barkley, this offense is probably one of the worst in the NFL. And somebody's going to say, well, by that notation, if you don't think the rest of the offense is very good, what is Daniel Jones supposed to do? Well, I'll tell you this. If you think he's that good, then he should be able to make mediocre players look really damn good. I mean, come on, man. If you're going to tell me that he's that good, why can't he get it done? I mean, what is the argument that you're going to use? I mean, every time it switches up, predicated upon what the necessity is, right?
Well, he doesn't have anybody around him. Well, he's so overrated. He had the most talented roster.
Figure it out, man. Me personally, I'm sticking with my original opinion of Daniel Jones. He's not him. All right, everybody. I am Drew Duncan. Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram is all at Drew Duncan Radio. I am wherever you are listening to podcasts. Simply tell your device to play Fired Up by Drew Duncan on iTunes, iHeart, Google, Spreaker, Deezer, etc. Wherever you're listening, I am there. I am brought to you in part by Block 50 Global Radio. Still plenty to get to today. We're going to be talking about Justin Fields' interview. And we're going to be talking about Eric Bieniemy. Can't believe he's not a coach. We've got college football to preview. Colorado, Oregon, Ohio State, Notre Dame, UCLA, Utah. Don't forget I am on YouTube and TikTok, The Real Drew Duncan. We're going to take a quick break. We'll be back. Don't you dare touch that dial. Hello, everybody. I am Drew Duncan. You guys are checking me out live on the show, Fired Up. Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram is all at Drew Duncan Radio. I am wherever you are listening to podcasts. Simply take advice to play Fired Up by Drew Duncan on iTunes, iHeart, Google, Spreaker, Deezer, etc. Wherever you're listening, I am there. Guys, still plenty of show to get to. We're going to be talking, obviously, about Eric Bieniemy. Why isn't he an NFL head football coach yet? Though he has been given a lot more responsibility in Washington. We're going to be talking about the interview from Justin Fields. I don't know why. I mean, it's a new week in Chicago, a new person to point the finger at, I suppose. We're going to talk about Ohio State, Notre Dame, UCLA, Utah. Let's get down to it. Colorado, Oregon. First of all, for anybody who's running around talking about the lack of schedule from the Colorado Buffaloes, here's Oregon's schedule. You know, they dropped 81 on the mighty Portland State football team. That was impressive. Then they beat Texas Tech 38-30. By the way, Texas Tech, the same team that lost to Wyoming and has that impressive win over Tarleton State. They beat Hawaii 55-10. That same Hawaii who had a hard time with Albany and lost to Stanford. So before we get into Colorado hasn't played anybody and Nebraska and TCU ended up being overrated, and after everybody thought they were going to lose to TCU, by the way, 20-point underdogs in that football game. In Colorado State, how much they struggled. Let's not forget Colorado State playing absolutely malicious football in that game. Before anybody talks about Colorado's schedule, Oregon's has clearly been no better. And when I say no better, I mean no better. Now, I know the conversation that's going to be going into this football game. It is going to be Bo Nix for Oregon, right? It's going to be a huge topic of discussion for anybody that says Oregon's going to win. I'm sorry, Bo Nix, first of all, he's like 40. Secondly, his entire college career has been built on flash in the pan moments combined with inconsistency. All right, now, I understand that leading up into this year, he'd only thrown 23 interceptions, which is great. I'm not saying that's bad. You don't turn the football over a lot, although it did happen when he first got there, right? So, and Oregon beat up on him. I mean, he played horrendously when he was at Auburn and he played against Oregon, right? So let's get that out of the way. In big games, he does turn the football over quite a bit. Now, overall, no, he hasn't. And when I say he's inconsistent, I mean, until he got to Oregon, I think he'd only thrown 39 touchdowns in 4 years. Or 3 years, pardon me. 39 touchdowns in 3 years. Not really going to get it done. Now, a lot of people are going to say, well, he's really good at running the football. He is. To me, he is kind of like a Tim Tebow type, all right? I like watching him play. He makes some amazing plays. There's no denying what Bo Nix is capable of. But I just have noticed in big games, he really kind of crumbles under the pressure. Honestly, if I'm Oregon, the way that I want to win this football game is, number one, I want to rely on that home crowd at Autzen Stadium. I mean, they are comparable to a WWE Attitude Era crowd. They are psychotic at Autzen Stadium. That's the first thing I'm going to do. Why? Because I don't want Colorado players to be able to make adjustments at the line of scrimmage. I don't want them to hear the play calls coming in. And we've already seen that with them before, right? How they can kind of get really rattled when they're on the road and you know, they have a difficult time with play calls and changing things at the line of scrimmage and all those types of things. So if I'm Oregon, that's first and foremost. I'm doing everything I can to get that crowd jacked, which I don't think we're going to have a hard time with, especially at the start of that football game. I mean, that's going to have to be the main thing. Of course, the antithesis for Colorado is learning how to deal with that noise to begin with. It is not a huge stadium at Autzen, but man alive, I know people that live in Oregon, and they're like, dude, I live 45 minutes from that stadium, and sometimes I can still hear them. That's how loud they are. That's first and foremost. Secondly, I am going to run the hell out of that football. And I mean, I want Jordan James and Bucky Irving to shove it down their throat. Because one of the things that I have talked about, and number one, it's going to take pressure off of Bo Nix. But number two, one of the things that I talked about since after the first game with TCU is Colorado's inability to not only run the football, but their inability to conversely stop the run. Both sides of the football, Colorado was not strong when it comes to the run game. And if I'm Oregon, I am exploiting the living hell out of it. Now, look, I know that Colorado State was really successful with all those drag routes and underneath throws, but I just feel like Colorado may be getting ready for that, thinking, well, now somebody believes that they found a real weakness in our defense. I just don't see that's going to be the case. I think they're going to double down and make adjustments for the underneath passing game. Now, conversely, that could leave you susceptible deep, especially not having Travis Hunter in there. It's already been determined he's going to be out for 3 to 4 weeks. So the fact of the matter is, when it boils down to Oregon, I'm thinking to myself, I don't want Bo Nix to have to beat this football team with his arm. In fact, I don't care if Bo Nix doesn't even throw for 200 yards in this game. I want Nix and James and Irving to run this football at a ridiculous rate. I mean, I'm running the football 40, 50 times, and I'm not even kidding. I am beating up that front line from the Colorado Buffaloes. I'm making them jam the box. I know Nix has got the arm. And so once they're sucked in all the way, we're going to bomb them deep, and we're going to hit them for a big play. And we're going to do that when we're up 21-7, when we're up 14-0, when we're up 14-7, and we are going to really try and destroy any sense of self that Colorado has. Because if I'm beating you up physically, I'm wearing you down mentally. And then when I'm able to get the big play and you're going, man, not only are they getting 8 yards a run on us, now they're messing around and they're getting 40 and 50, 60-yard pass plays on us as well. We can't stop these guys. That's what I'm doing. Look, they're still human, man. I don't know if anybody knows this or not. For all the brash and everything that's over in Colorado, which, again, I love Coach Prime. I'm just saying that I would take that and I would use it against them. I would take their strength and turn it into a weakness. Now, for Colorado to win, obviously, for me, what I just said, they're going to have to be able to stop the run game. You know, I don't know if Oregon's going to look at Colorado and go, I think that that's going to be their primary focus. Look, if I'm Deion Sanders, I don't think Bo Nix can beat me. I really don't. I don't think that he can drop back 35, 40 times on me and win that football game. I'm bull rushing. I'm shooting gaps. I'm stunting. I am going to consistently put pressure on that offensive line, and I'm going to try and confuse Nix with something that I haven't shown just yet. I've got something special in mind just for you. Now, obviously, it's going to hurt a little bit not having Travis Hunter. I'm not saying that it's not. What I'm saying is Deion Sanders still knows how to coach in a way of putting yourself in the best position. And I want to keep everything in front of me. I'm making it look like man when it's really a zone and vice versa. That's what I'm doing. Bo Nix is not going to beat you alone with his arm. He can't do it. And to be honest with you, I'm giving signals out to where my spies are because I'm not having the same spy on him all the time. It's not always going to be a linebacker or a safety or whomever. I'm going to back off my two defensive ends when I think they're going to run an option play or try to get Nix going, you know, or if it's a pass play, seal off those edges with my defensive ends and I'm backing them into a spy position. And then in that spy position, I'm using my linebackers to shoot those gaps that are there to try and plug up those holes. But I don't want anybody to get to the outside. I don't want Bo Nix thinking he's going to scramble around and make plays. And I damn sure want to mix up those coverages on the back end because I don't want him to look directly at my defense and know exactly what's in front of him. He's just not good enough to do it. So if I'm Deion, that's what I'm doing. And then offensively, look, I've said all along, they really need to get that run game going. They have got to figure it out with Edwards. That offensive line is horrible at run blocking. Coincidentally, as bad as they are at run blocking, they are as good at pass pro. I don't know what to tell you. And Shador may be playing a little tired, but I think he's going to be playing with fire. So there you go. All right, everybody. I am Drew Duncan. Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram is all at Drew Duncan Radio. Still plenty of show to get to. We're going to be talking about Eric Bieniemy, Ohio State, Notre Dame. Don't you dare touch that dial. Everybody, I am Drew Duncan. You guys are checking me out live on the program Fired Up. Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram is all at Drew Duncan Radio. I am wherever you are listening to podcasts. If you miss the show live, simply tell your device to play Fired Up by Drew Duncan on iTunes, iHeart, Google, Spreaker, Deezer, etc. Wherever you are listening, I am there. Guys, still plenty to get to today. We're going to be talking about Justin Fields. Why is he the new person to blame in Chicago? We're going to be talking about Ohio State, Notre Dame. We're going to be talking about UCLA, Utah. But right now, what I want to get to is Eric Bieniemy. If there is anybody that can explain to me why Eric Bieniemy is not a head coach right now in the NFL, then I would love to entertain you. Here are some interesting numbers when you think about the Kansas City Chiefs. Andy Reid was hired in 2013. In fact, I think it was in December when he took that job. Let's think about that. It's 2013. They blow that huge lead to the Indianapolis Colts in the playoffs. That was the wild card. 2015, they won against the Texans, but the Texans, honestly, they snuck in that season. And then they turn around and they got beat by New England. Then they were one and done against the Steelers. Then here comes Eric Bieniemy. They go to the AFC Championship game. They get beat. Controversy was in that game. Regardless, they get beat. Next season, Super Bowl win. Next season, Super Bowl loss, but they were there. Next season, AFC title loss to the Bengals. Last year, Super Bowl win against the Philadelphia Eagles. Eric Bieniemy is there, and that offense a season ago had over 7,000 yards. Far and away the number one offense in the NFL. No Eric Bieniemy, they are right now tied for 22nd worst in the NFL. A season ago, that Washington football team, horrendous. 24th in the NFL in offense. Already this season, they currently rank 7th best in the NFL. And as bad as they looked in that first half against Denver, they were absolutely stupendous in that second half. And as a diehard Broncos fan, I could tell you, they went into halftime and they made adjustments. And let's not forget who he's doing this with. Look, I want to make something very clear, first of all. I'm not saying that Patrick Mahomes showing up and being the starter had nothing to do with it. Everything kind of converged at the right time for the Kansas City Chiefs. Eric Bieniemy moves into the OC position. Patrick Mahomes is there for his next year. He's now deemed the starter. They go all the way to the AFC Championship game. It's hosted in Kansas City, by the way. Now, all of a sudden, they're having all these problems with drop passes and execution in the red zone and poor play calling and the inability to finish drives. And Eric Bieniemy is gone, but you still got number 15. Now, obviously, number 15 isn't to blame for a lot of it. Clearly, we can point to all the drops and things of that nature. But let's be honest, that offense does look a little different now. And I'm not saying that it's not because they're not missing key guys, but again, there's still some pieces from last season's football team. Let's not forget that. Right now, his quarterback is Sam Howell, who didn't show anybody anything a season ago for Washington. I think he was in for one game, didn't even throw for 200 yards, one TD and two INTs. This season, he's thrown one interception so far. Not a good look into the early part of the season, but it's only been one. Okay. Obviously, compared to somebody like Josh Allen, right? Let's go with that. Four turnovers in one football game. Didn't throw a single pick against that Denver defense. What do you have? 299 yards against Denver the other day? I'm telling you right now. And I mean, this is, again, it's a no-name football team. It really is a no-name football team with Eric Bieniemy and company. Now, sure, obviously, diehard Washington fans, maybe NFC East fans, are going to know who a lot of these guys are. But let's be honest, on a national scale, to the regular football fan who watches games that are just on national television, they're not going to know any of these guys. That's the reality of it. The point of what I'm saying is Sam Howell is no Patrick Mahomes. And Eric Bieniemy, with whatever he's doing, however he's coaching, whatever his position is in the offense, right? Because he's been given more responsibility, a bigger office. You know, he gets to decide, you know, what the off days are and all those things. He's the one in charge of just about everything in the regard of the offense right now. He's just so many more responsibilities, right? He's been given so much more leeway and freedom. And look at the immediate turnaround so far for Washington. This is huge. And you're going to tell me that in Arizona, that dork that's coaching the football team out there right now, Jonathan, you're going to tell me that guy's a good football coach? You got, who drove here? Who rode a bus? You got fire in your gut? Bring that fire with you? Bro, it's the NFL. There's a league stipend minimum that's more than $500,000. At the bare minimum, Brody showed up in a Toyota Camry. Are you kidding me right now? And you're going to tell me Eric Bieniemy doesn't have a job as a head coach in the NFL? If Washington wins at least 11 games this year and that offense keeps going the way that it's been going this season, if Eric Bieniemy doesn't have a job next year as a head coach, I am in fact boycotting the NFL. Because at that point, that is beyond suspect. There have been coaches that have had one good season as an offensive or defensive coordinator that got work. Josh McDaniels failed miserably with the Denver Broncos and is still the coach of the Raiders, who are not good. That win over Denver doesn't matter. I'm a Broncos fan. I am the first one to tell you right now, they are a tune-up game at this point. That's the way that it is. Raiders are not going to be good this season. If they make the playoffs, fine, I'll eat my words, but I'm 99% sure that I'm secure in that prediction, all right? It's disgusting that Eric Bieniemy doesn't have a job. By the way, the coach over at Arizona getting a job after being the defensive coordinator with the Philadelphia Eagles, that same defense that gave up 28 points a game a season ago. That should tell you how good Jalen Hurts is. I'm telling you right now, there's literally no reason for Eric Bieniemy to not be a coach somewhere in the NFL. At the bare minimum, getting a call from a university. There's got to be a college out there that thinks to themselves, we could use Eric Bieniemy as a head coach around here. We could use whatever he's got going on in the NFL. I want it down here. And I mean, just some teams in the Big 12 alone have got to be looking around. Cincinnati, Houston, Texas Tech, it looks like they're probably going to want a new coach after this is all said and done. Baylor. If TCU can't figure out a way to turn this season around, there's literally no reason. Come on, Illinois, Iowa, which we're going to get into them a little bit later on. Hey, I don't get it. Someone's just, well, I was ranked right now. Yeah, right now, bro. Just wait. What am I missing? What do I not know that everybody else does? I don't get it. Everybody, I am Drew Duncan. Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram is all at Drew Duncan Radio. I am wherever you are listening to podcasts. If we tell you advice to play Fired Up by Drew Duncan, iTunes, iHeart, Google, Spreaker, Deezer, etc., wherever you're listening, I am there. Guys, still plenty to get to. Why is Justin Fields the new person to have the finger pointed out in Chicago? We're going to be talking about Ohio State, Notre Dame, UCLA, Utah. I am brought to you in part by Block 50 Global Radio. Block 50 Global Radio is online all day, every day at zenofm.com/Block50 Global Radio. We're going to take a break, pay some bills. We'll be back right after this. Don't you dare touch that dial. Everybody, I am Drew Duncan. You guys are checking me out live on the show Fired Up. Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram is all at Drew Duncan Radio. I am wherever you're listening to podcasts. Simply tell your device to play Fired Up by Drew Duncan. iTunes, iHeart, Google, Spreaker, wherever you're listening, I am there. In addition, I am on TikTok and YouTube. Simply look for the real Drew Duncan. I am brought to you in part by Block 50 Global Radio. Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram, TikTok, it's all Block 50 Global Radio. Still plenty of show to get to today. A little bit later on, we're going to be talking about Justin Fields. Is it right to point the finger at him right now in Chicago? I mean, after all, last week it was Chase Claypool. Now it's him. Now it's Justin Fields. All right, whatever, bro. We're going to be talking about UCLA and Utah a little bit later on. In the meantime, I want to get into Ohio State Notre Dame coming up this Saturday. Boy, this is the game that everybody's been waiting on for Notre Dame, hasn't it? Because to a lot of people, this is going to be the game that determines how good Notre Dame really is this season. Now, I'm not saying that it's not going to be a good measuring stick, because it is. But I personally don't think that Kyle McCord is good enough at quarterback for Ohio State to get the job done. Way too many high balls. Left Marvin Harrison out to dry. I really don't believe that he is poised enough. He makes terrible decisions back there in the pocket. The crossbody interception, for instance, against Indiana. Not a big fan of that, obviously. You know, and I get it. Everybody makes mistakes. You know, he's still getting used to the offense. But, and somebody's going to talk about last week against, you know, what was it, Western Kentucky. But that's Western Kentucky, bro. And if you don't win that game at least 63-10, you haven't done your damn job. That's all I'm saying. Now, somebody who listens to the show frequently is going to go, well, you don't say that about Texas. Yes, I do. Yes, I do. I'm not impressed with Texas's win over Rice. I'm not impressed with that at all. They got over in Alabama, but right now they're so confused about who the hell their quarterback even is. Nick Saban looks like a first-year head coach being so indecisive. I'll be honest with you. This season, I would equate him to Lane Kiffin. No clue what the hell's going on. I'm just keeping it really real. I don't think that win over Alabama is significant right now. That's all I'm saying. And I don't think Notre Dame has a significant win either. Look, that schedule for Notre Dame is pretty mundane this season. I'm going to be honest with you. I am impressed, though, with Estime. I think he is the best running back in all of college football. I think they potentially have the best offensive line in all of college football. I think they may have, at least at the bare minimum, one of the top three defensive lines in all of college football. I haven't seen Sam Hartman play against the defense yet where I've thought, A, he is that guy, and B, this is a defense that can really test him. Ohio State's defense, to me, is not going to be much better on the back end. So what am I saying? I'm saying that Notre Dame should win this game by 2 scores. That's what I'm saying. 10, 12, 13, 14, somewhere in that neighborhood. I don't think it's going to be an egregious blowout. All right? I would look for this game to be somewhere in the neighborhood of like, you know, 27-13, 27-14, 31-17, somewhere in that neighborhood. Okay? I think Ohio State is going to get slowly worn down by Estime, by the running game. I think Kyle McCord is going to be under intense pressure, and I don't think he's going to be able to deal with it. Again, the high balls, leaving Marvin Harrison Jr. out to dry. I don't think he's got enough game experience for a game of this magnitude. I know Ohio State fans probably going to jump down my throat, and that's fine. But the reality of it is show me where you really believe that your team is that good. Mind you, last season, I was actually a huge fan of Ohio State's football team in that I said they were the one team that could compete with Georgia because offensively, they matched up better than anybody else in the country. To me, that was the national championship game or the college football playoff championship. To me, it was. That was a hell of a football game. This season, it is a completely looking different, you know, looking football team. And the thing is, you know, and this is something that is common right now in college football for some weird reason this season. Teams not knowing who their quarterbacks are right away. Again, Ohio State, another football team that we saw go with the two quarterback system to begin with. We saw this in Houston, who I'm going to talk about a little bit later on as well. We've seen it with Alabama, hitting a panic button, going with a couple of different quarterbacks in last weekend's football game. Just not a fan of that. You pick a guy and you go with him. I know that we all make promises, but sometimes you overcommit. It's just the way that it is. And you got to pick a guy and you got to go with him, and you have to give your team confidence in that guy from the jump. And I think if it all breaks down in Alabama, or pardon me, in Ohio State, I don't think those players, because of how it's already gone, the significance with the Indiana game, I think they're going to look at Kyle McCord and they're going to get a little worried. They're not going to look at him like this dude can save the day. He can take over a game. It's not going to happen. Conversely, we haven't seen it with Sam Hartman yet Notre Dame either, have we? So if for whatever reason the run game breaks down with Estime, is Hartman going to be able to step up and be the true MVP of that football team? That's the lingering question. Because if Ohio State does prove to be a very good matchup for the Fighting Irish, that's what that game is going to amount to. In fact, that is what most difficult games amount to. Sometimes it's just a straight up grind out win. Both teams are just playing physical football, and it boils down to whoever runs the football the best or makes one or two really good pass plays in the end. But I just really think that Notre Dame is not only more talented, I think they're better coached. That's another thing. Notre Dame knew who their guy was. They went after Sam Hartman. They pulled him out of Wake Forest. They sent that other kid on over to Alabama. They sent the offensive coordinator over there. They're in a good situation at Notre Dame. In fact, I'm willing to say that for the first time in probably about 20-some years, if I'm being honest with you. Didn't think that Brian Kelly was going to do anything there. He didn't. College football playoff, blown out. BCS national championship game against Alabama, blown out. At the end of the day, what did he ever really do? I think everybody loved him when he was at Cincinnati. Got that team to go undefeated, but he never finished the job, did he? And the way he did Notre Dame, come on. I feel like Notre Dame has found their coach. I feel like Notre Dame has found their identity. And I feel like Notre Dame is in the best position of anybody right now in college football to make a huge statement for the CFP. They need this game. Not only do they need this game, but they need Ohio State to go on and win big going down the road. Look, Michigan's going to be playing Rutgers this weekend, right? Jim Harbaugh, I think, is going to be back this weekend. Ohio State, Michigan, to me, all eyes are going to be on those two teams in the Big Ten. Penn State, obviously, with Iowa, but I really think that Penn State is that underdog that nobody's looking at because they don't think they can get it done when they may be the best team in the Big Ten. But here's the thing, though. For Notre Dame, that's what they need because they need Ohio State to win and win big, and then they need them to show up and show out against Michigan later on in the season. That's all I'm saying. This is Notre Dame's chance. If they want to prove they're ready, now's the time. Everybody, I am Drew Duncan. Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram is all at Drew Duncan Radio. The show is called Fired Up. I am wherever you are listening to podcasts. Simply tell your device to play Fired Up by Drew Duncan, iTunes, iHeart, Google, Spreaker, Deezer, etc. Wherever you're listening, I am there. Still plenty more to get to. We're going to be talking about UCLA playing Utah coming up this weekend. We're going to be talking about why is Justin Fields now the brunt end of everything that's going on in Chicago. Is it fair or not? I am brought to you in part by Block 50 Global Radio. Block 50 Global Radio is online on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram, as well as 24/7, zenofm.com/Block50 Global Radio. Don't you dare touch that dial. Everybody, I am Drew Duncan. You guys are checking me out live on Block 50 Global Radio. Thank you for tuning in. Do not forget that Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram is all at Block 50 Global Radio. And, of course, they are wherever you are listening to podcasts. I am Drew Duncan. Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram is all at Drew Duncan. TikTok and YouTube is the real Drew Duncan. And I also am wherever you're listening to podcasts. Plenty more to get to. We're going to be back right after this quick commercial break. Don't you dare touch that dial. Everybody, I am Drew Duncan. You guys are checking me out live on the program Fired Up. Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram is all at Drew Duncan Radio. I am wherever you're listening to podcasts. Simply tell your device to play Fired Up by Drew Duncan on iTunes, iHeart, Spreaker, Deezer, etc. Wherever you're listening, I am there. Additionally, I am on TikTok and YouTube. Simply look for the real Drew Duncan. Guys, I am brought to you in part by Block 50 Global Radio. Still plenty of show to get to. A little bit later on, we're going to be talking about UCLA, Utah. We've got more college football to preview. In addition to that, we'll be talking a little NFL. Speaking of college football, doesn't Wisconsin play on Friday night? Who do they have? They got Purdue. That ought to be about as entertaining as two goats walking around in a circle. Man, it's just boring. Some of those teams in the Big Ten are just so damn boring. Way that it is. All right, Justin Fields. Boy, I tell you what, last week it was Claypool, now it's Fields. You know, and before that it was the coach, it was the offensive coordinator, it's been John Fox, it's been Adam Gase, it's been, you know, Eberflus, and it's been this, it's been that, and, you know, it's been Jay Cutler is soft, it's Brian Urlacher sticking up for Jay Cutler and then turning into a bad ex after the fact and saying Jay Cutler's not that guy. And boy, the Bears over the last, boy, I tell you what, since they got stomped in that Super Bowl, have just been a disaster. Been a disaster. Just can't put it together. You know, I was watching the Bears-Bucks game, and right out of the gate, Justin Fields looked so good. He was threading the needle. He was beating defenders with the ball to where they were trying to get to. He just looked so impressive on that first drive. It was really difficult to surmise what was going on, right? And when he was asked about it, he talked a little bit about play calling, which probably tells you he's not comfortable back there, especially when he's like, you know, I just really don't want to think about it. I just want to be able to run on instinct, you know? So when somebody says they want their instinct to just go, that tells me one of two things. Either they're not comfortable with the play calling, or they're just not getting in maybe the reps that they should with certain looks. Maybe it's a film room study thing. I don't know. But for me, it just really sounds like he's not comfortable with what the offense is trying to do with him. Look, here's the thing. When you go out and you get a quarterback, and this is pretty much football 101, the whole idea of he's a guy you can build a team around is doing, in fact, just that, building a team around him. And what does that team need to incorporate? Guys that are full of what he can do to best make him great. Because when you're playing into his strengths and the guys that are around him are familiar with a system that will work for him, that's how you get it done. You know, Troy Aikman has talked about it umpteen times. You bring a guy in and you try to change who he is. Why? You looked at him. You saw he was good enough to be there. What are you trying to do? I mean, let's be honest. Of course, a quarterback has to eventually be a quarterback. There's not a quarterback in the NFL that can rely on their legs for their entire career. That goes for John Elway, who, when he retired, said, I just can't do it physically anymore. That goes for Randall Cunningham. That goes for Mike Vick. That goes for everybody. I mean, look at all the injuries to Mike Vick. It goes for everybody. Steve Young, all the concussions, you know, it catches up to you. And eventually, in order to be a quarterback in the NFL, you have to be able to be a quarterback. Tom Brady, we all know, not the most agile guy on planet Earth. Still, you know, he made some plays with his legs, and he was a lot better at getting away from guys than people ever really give him credit for when it comes to just evading somebody who's trying to tackle him, not get away necessarily. But his accuracy, his understanding of the system, his understanding of what the defense is doing before they're doing it, and knowing exactly where the open guy is going to be, looking everybody off, and probably just using his peripheral to make double sure the guy's going to be there, and bam, hit him. That's Tom Brady football, and if he's got to, he can take it deep on you, whether you like that or not. So I understand that at some point you have to be that guy. But you know, Justin Fields is so much more of a traditional option quarterback, and I'm not saying he doesn't have the gun, because he certainly does. But to me, when he says what he says, he's just not comfortable with what's going on. But this football team has had so many issues that have gone way beyond Claypool and Justin Fields. All right? I have been critical of Justin Fields long before he made it to the NFL because he's an Ohio State quarterback. But that doesn't mean that what's going on with Chicago is squarely on him. First of all, the defense hasn't been the greatest, okay? They're pretty good at stealing edges, but man, if you run the football at the middle and those guys, it's a foregone conclusion at 7 yards. There were defenders that you could clearly see, double coverage, Baker Mayfield throwing it to a spot, guys being able to adjust, look back at the ball, and no defenders are making a move on the ball. They're just watching it go into his hands.
Oh, man, that was a nice turnaround and catch, bro. Good for you, Mike Evans.
I mean, seriously. The offensive line is hit and miss. The play calling is hit and miss. Really, the only receiver that he's got over there right now is DJ Moore. Claypool just, and I know someone's going to go, well, three interceptions. All right. I'll give you the little screenplay. That was a pretty lazy little toss. All right. As far as the interception of Claypool goes, I'll give you the fact that that was an inside ball. I'm not going to say that. But on the third pick, that ball was just ripped away. Right? So I'm willing to give Justin Fields two of those interceptions. But that third one, come on. What I'm saying is, it's not just Justin Fields. That football team from top to bottom, and then, of course, what was it, the defensive coordinator that just got announced, what was it, about 4 o'clock yesterday, that Williams is, he's resigning, citing that, you know, it's health and family and all those things, which, you know, God bless him. You've got to take care of yourself first. That's always the priority, you and your family. I don't have an issue with it, but what I'm saying is that it only adds, and I think Eberflus has said that, at least for now, you know, because he took over on Sunday for the play calling for the Chicago Bears defensively, and now he's going to do it again this weekend. And I look at the Chicago Bears, and I just see top to bottom a football team that cannot get it together. It is not just on them. Yes, Justin Fields has sacks where he holds onto the ball too much, but he also gets sacks because he's back there trying to be a quarterback and his guys aren't getting open. The Chicago Bears are in a damned if you do and damned if you don't situation with Justin Fields. It's just, for whatever reason, it doesn't all click on the same day with them. If they have a good day offensively, defensively, they can't get it done, and vice versa. And I just really think that there's just too much inconsistency with that football team as a whole from top to bottom. One of the things I talked about last week when everybody tried to point the finger at Claypool was, look, this football team is not a Claypool problem. They are an everything problem. There's a lot of lazy players on that football team. There's a lot of guys who aren't hustling on that football team. There's a lot of bad play calling on that football team. It's obvious that they're not fully prepared when they're out there on game days. If Justin Fields, look, he tried to backtrack a little bit and say, well, you know, part of that's on me. Coach is giving me the tools. I just got to go out there and execute the game plan. I'm getting robotic. What is he bored with the offense? I mean, what is it? This entire thing is a mess because the Chicago Bears are a mess. Not because one player, one coach, or one person is. The front office is making bad decisions. They're not putting the guys together that need to be on the roster together as a unit. You can't just go out and try and get everybody else's best player and decide that that's going to be what makes you a successful football team. It's not how the NFL works. This isn't college. And even then, it doesn't really work in college. If I had to point the finger, Eberflus, just because of his name. Everybody, I am Drew Duncan. We still got plenty more to get to. A lot of college football to talk about. Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram is all at Drew Duncan. We'll be back right after this. Don't you dare touch that dial. Hello, everybody. I am Drew Duncan. You guys are checking me out live on the show Fired Up. Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram is all at Drew Duncan Radio. If you miss the show live, I am wherever you are listening to podcasts. Simply say advice to play Fired Up by Drew Duncan on iTunes, iHeart, Google, Spreaker, Deezer. Wherever you're listening, I am there. Still plenty to get to. A lot more college football to discuss. And I'm not backing down on making fun of Eberflus's last name. Hell no. Eberflus. If I'm even, is it Eberflus or Eberflus? See, look, I might be the jerk, you know? What are you going to do? But I maintain my position about the Bears, though. That's not going to change. They're a nightmare from top to bottom. You can't just blame Fields. You can't just blame Claypool. Those guys are just the tip of the iceberg of what's going on in Chicago. Already, we've talked about the 49ers and Giants. We've talked about Colorado, Oregon. We discussed why Eric Bieniemy should be a head coach by now. Talked about Ohio State, Notre Dame. If you missed the show live and want to go back and listen to those segments, well, I am wherever you're listening to podcasts, iTunes, iHeart, Google, Spreaker, Deezer. I don't know, man. It goes out to like 25 of them. That's all I know. Then, of course, a lot of websites put it up there, too, as their podcast. But another story another time. In the meantime, guys, UCLA and Utah. Boy, this is one, isn't it? And this is one that's really difficult because I haven't been a fan of Chip Kelly since he's been at UCLA. No more DTR. Dante Moore is not playing bad. They probably have found their quarterback in him. I will say this. He definitely wasn't – you don't want him to get hurt. You know, their backup, Ethan, I think he's got one TD, two interceptions, a total QBR of like 22.7 somewhere in that neighborhood. So you certainly don't want anything to happen to Dante Moore, even just from not just a sportsmanship perspective, but obviously there's not a lot of depth there in UCLA, right? So that's kind of one thing I think about with UCLA. They've got a damn good quarter or running back, pardon me, in Carson Steele. I think Harden is a pretty good running back. What, he had that 57-yarder the other day against San Diego State, so he looks pretty good. You know, they got Lau at wide receiver. You know, they got Luda at, you know, on defense. You know, their new defensive coordinator, Don John Lynn, not really sure how I feel about him yet. Look, defensively, what I've seen from UCLA is poor tackling. Right, they get pushed around pretty easily. Again, they're not bad at sealing off edges, but you know, similar to what I said about Chicago, you can run it right down the middle of their throat. No big deal. They really didn't finish off San Diego State. You know, I know people were going to say, "Well, it was a blowout," and yeah, I think that game would have been closer if it hadn't been for a dumb play call after the turnover. San Diego State on the goal line. Well, what was that play? Was it a push pass? Was it a screen? It didn't look like a shovel play. I don't know what the hell that thing was supposed to be. Could have just lined up and snuck that thing in there or fullback up the middle. I mean, something, you know? It doesn't have to be cute to win football games, you know? So I feel like San Diego State took themselves out of the last opportunity that they had to get into that football game, you know? And then I look at Utah. Man, you know, I don't know. What I do know is that I probably like Chip Kelly a little bit more than I do Whittingham at this juncture when it comes to coaches. Whittingham, I didn't like the two quarterback system that I saw him run. I saw inconsistency, especially first game of the year, right out of the gate, right? Throw it deep. You got a quarterback, he's in rhythm. You go back, you change it. Yeah, whether Nate Johnson's going to be the quarterback or not, who knows? They're discussing Cam Rising. They're supposed to make a decision on that at some point today. So as of the moment of this show airing, there's no decision on Cam Rising yet for Utah. I think Utah is missing the run game. I think that could potentially hurt them. So when I look at these two football teams, I really got to try and ask myself, what are the make or breaks for either one of these teams where I can say definitively, I think this team should win? Well, if I'm being honest with you, some people are going to say, well, Utah's had the tougher schedule, right? They played Florida. Florida beat Tennessee. But then again, we don't know how the Tennessee win is going to look for Florida. Kind of similar to last season, right? Florida beat Utah, but Utah goes on to be a Pac-12 champion. Florida doesn't even have a 500 season. Let that sink in. It is really difficult to figure out who I like. Chip Kelly really hasn't been able to, or wanted to, I should say, change anything about his philosophy. I think maybe this season they look a little bit different in some of what he's willing to do offensively. When it comes down to it, I would say that I like Chip Kelly better as a coach. I like the fact that they've established their quarterback for a longer period of time, Dante Moore. I think even if Cam Rising were to come back for this football game, how good will he be after, you know, last season and then missing already, what is it, three games going into this season? So when I look at it, I think to myself, on paper, UCLA should win. Now, that doesn't mean they will. I mean, obviously, we saw Utah last season, you know, a couple of comeback games, but that was then. This is now. I just don't think they're that football team, if I'm being honest with you. I don't think they repeat as Pac-12 champions. I think that UCLA, Oregon, USC, maybe even Colorado, obviously we'll see how they do against Oregon this coming Saturday, are all better football teams than Utah. And I think it's because of the coaching. Look, I've talked about this before, and I've talked about it a million times. I'll probably end up talking about it a million times over through the course of my career. You have to give your team confidence in somebody. I don't like Notre Dame going out and getting Sam Hartman because I don't know what he's going to do with that football team. But at least from the beginning, they gave the team confidence in Sam Hartman. That was their guy from the jump. Talked about it with Ohio State. Two quarterback system. Finally went with Kyle McCord. I just don't like the initial message that it sends. I don't like the message that Nick Saban is sending right now in Alabama. I'm just not with it. I don't like it. It's not just about the confidence that the team has within the guy. It's about the guy building that confidence, even in a loss, that, look, you're still him. You're still our guy. We're sticking with you. Let's figure out a way to turn this thing around and go get it done next week. Not doing that. I think Dante Moore, this is a game for him where I don't know if we'll see a breakout game. But I do think that if UCLA, and this is the thing that I've always said about Chip Kelly, and I was saying this back in like 2014. I don't know why people think his spread look is a pass look. It's not. It is an option game, deceptive as a spread passing game. He just hurries the hell up. That's really it. It's not anything insane, if I'm being honest with you. It is simple football at its core. Now, obviously, between Dante Moore and Cam Rising would be my quarterback, right? But I think with the layoff that he's had, even if he does play, I just don't think he's going to be able to get the job done. Again, the injuries probably mounting up, which is sad, obviously, because I think it's going to blow his ride to the NFL, unfortunately. And the fact of the matter is, I don't know that I'm going to trust Kyle Whittingham as the head coach. Look, this has been a long process for Kyle Whittingham. And I'm not saying that Utah is an easy place to recruit, because it's not. And I'm sorry, people who live in Utah, you have beautiful mountains and all that good stuff there. But I'm going to tell you what you don't have. And that is a place where people go and feel like, I could come here and kick it. That's all there is to that. It is a tough place to recruit. It ain't LA. All right. It's not Austin, Texas with a good scene. All right. It's none of those places. Not even close. It's cold. It's beautiful scenery. It's cool to go and visit. It's not okay to be there for an entire school year for a guy who's 21 years old and wants to hang out. That's all I'm saying. But I think when you got the guys, though, got to get it right. We'll be back right after this. Hello, everybody. I am Drew Duncan. You guys are checking me out live on the show, Fired Up. Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram is all at Drew Duncan Radio. I am wherever you're listening to podcasts. If you miss the show live, simply tell your device to play Fired Up by Drew Duncan on iTunes, iHeart, Google, Spreaker, Deezer, etc. Wherever you're listening, I am there. Show recap coming up on the final segment of the day. Guys, don't forget, am I on TikTok? Yes. The Real Drew Duncan, YouTube, The Real Drew Duncan. I am wherever you are listening to podcasts. I am brought to you in part by Block 50 Global Radio. Block 50 Global Radio is online 24/7 at zenofm.com/Block50 Global Radio. They are also online, TikTok, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, Block 50 Global Radio. LA Rams, McVay, he admits that they are looking and they have been talking with other teams to trade Cam Akers. Look, I think Cam Akers could go somewhere else and be very successful. I really do. I think he needs to go somewhere, though, where there's already a pretty good established running back. And he would serve as a maybe new starter or somebody he could split time with. I just, you know, the Rams are a fickle football team this year so far. I look at them and I see a pretty good team in terms of their pass protect. So pass pro, I really don't have an issue with when it comes to their offensive line. And when it comes to running the football, I have an issue with their offensive line. They're not that good, which generally we see the antithesis, right? Usually you can look at an offensive line and go, man, they are so good at run blocking, but damn, they can't. They couldn't block a blitz on a backside beta for nothing when it comes to pass protection. I mean, they couldn't block a D2 football team. Then, of course, you got offensive lines that are just terrible. So as much as I would love to see him with the Denver Broncos, I don't know that he would fit in there, although I think it's a good possibility. You know, I think with running a lot of the shotgun formations that Denver does and what they do with Russell Wilson, I think Cam Akers would potentially work there. I think he would also potentially work out with the Philadelphia Eagles. I think he would do very well there. Again, to me, Philly could be the best running team as it stands right now in the NFL as it is anyway. I think you add another piece of that puzzle, and you could easily have two 1,000-yard rushers with the Philadelphia Eagles. I really believe that. I don't think the Jets need anybody. I think their running game is already strong. I just think Nathaniel Hackett needs to be willing to switch up his coaching a little bit to get the Jets into the next realm. I think they're a team that could be great if they just ran the football more. I agree with Brees 110%. Other teams that I think he would serve well in, and I don't know that he could go to New Orleans. Obviously, Kamara's there, but you would have two similar style running backs with the New Orleans Saints, and I think Cam Akers is beyond serviceable for you, so he could split time with Kamara, and I think he would be very successful. Obviously, Dobbins, he's out with the Baltimore Ravens. I think Cam Akers could potentially go there, be very successful. He would be the guy, at least, so at least in my estimation, he would be. So I think the Baltimore Ravens would be a really good look for Cam Akers, if I'm being honest with you. But then again, if I'm the Rams, I'm not looking to trade him unless he wants to be traded. If he wants to be traded, that's a different thing, at which point, I'll be honest with you, I wouldn't blame him at this juncture. I really wouldn't. Again, pass protection, I don't think is that bad with the LA Rams. I think where they fall short is run blocking, which is really odd because they've been so good at it over the last few seasons. But it is what it is. It could be a scheme thing. It could be a personnel thing in a locker room. I mean, who the hell knows? It could be one of a million things. And even then, when we look at it, one of the things that I've always said, if somebody goes somewhere else, it's not just a talent-based thing. There are plenty of talented players out there that will not work in another scheme, in another locker room, whatever the case may be. You go look at Odell Beckham Jr., regardless of what anybody wants to say about him, his players have always said he's nothing but professional and great to be around. Didn't matter if he was with the Browns, the Giants, the Rams, whomever. Schematically, it didn't work for him in Cleveland. Plus, he kept getting hurt. Okay? So that was the issue with him. Antonio Brown, such a huge thing. Him going to the Raiders, Derek Carr, I'm open, baby, I'm open. That didn't work out for a million and one reasons, namely most of which were the fault of Antonio Brown. I'm not going to get into the possible or the possibility of CTE, any of that stuff. I'm just saying right now on a surface level, it just didn't work out. Right. So Cam Akers, to me, one of the most talented running backs in the NFL, I think could be a premier back for most teams in the NFL. But wherever he goes, is it not only going to be a good fit schematically, but within the locker room? I think the Baltimore Ravens, to be honest with you, probably fit the bill overall from that standpoint. I think schematically they would work. And I also think that he would fit really well in the locker room. Now, schematically, I think he works just about anywhere. I don't think you need a specifically designed offense for Cam Akers. But I do think, though, the best places for him would be in Baltimore, would be in Philly, and then potentially with the New Orleans Saints. I think their styles mesh well with what he's got going on. I think he would probably work out in Denver, maybe take some pressure off that offensive line. But, you know, with Javonte Williams, when's he coming back? You know, who knows? So, again, I just think that the best places for him, off the top of my head, the Saints, the Eagles, and the Ravens. I think those are the teams that suit him best from a schematic standpoint. And then just from what I've heard and seen in interviews, I think the locker rooms, he would mesh well also. Guys, I am Drew Duncan. Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram is all at Drew Duncan Radio. I am brought to you in part by Block 50 Global Radio. Block 50 Global Radio is online wherever you are, Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram, 24/7 on ZenoFM.com/Block50 Global Radio. We're going to take a quick break. We've got the show recap coming up after this. Guys, don't forget I'm wherever you're listening to podcasts, iTunes, iHeart, Google, Deezer, Spreaker. We'll be back right after this. Don't you dare touch that dial. I am Drew Duncan. You guys are checking me out live on the show Fired Up. Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram is all at Drew Duncan Radio. I am wherever you are listening to podcasts. Simply take advice to play Fired Up by Drew Duncan on iTunes, iHeart, Google, Spreaker, Deezer, etc. Wherever you're listening, I am there. I am brought to you in part by Block 50 Global Radio. Block 50 Global Radio is online 24/7, ZenoFM.com/Block50 Global Radio. Little show recap for you guys. Again, the 49ers, Giants, I think we're about to finally put the Danny Dimes baby to bed. I think we're all about to find out just how bad that football team is without Saquon Barkley. You think they were having a hard time before? Just wait until they meet that 49ers defense without him. It's going to be an ugly nightmare. Again, I won't be surprised if Frisco puts up a 30-point win or better on the Giants. I think that we need to stop trying to figure out the one issue with the Chicago Bears. You know, the Bears are just a football team that are from top to bottom bad. That's the front office all the way down to what's going on the football field. They're not good. And everybody needs to stop trying to figure out the one thing that's wrong with this football team. It's everything. Everything. They are bad at everything. All there is to it. Stop trying to blame Justin Fields. Stop trying to blame Claypool. Okay. I'm not saying that they're without sin. What I'm saying is it's bad all over there. That's all. All right. Eric Bieniemy, and I literally mean this. I am protesting the NFL next season if he's not a head football coach. It's to a point where it's literally inexcusable. There's absolutely no way in hell that you could think of 10 coaches right now, 10 football teams that all have better coaches than Eric Bieniemy. I would think that the Saints might want to look somewhere. I would have thought the Arizona Cardinals going into this season would have wanted to look at Bieniemy. I mean, the Arizona Cardinals for sure. Coaches can get fired after a very mediocre season. I mean, honestly, Jacksonville, bye, Peterson. Give me Bieniemy. I'm just saying. Colorado, Oregon. Look, if I'm Oregon, I'm running it down their throat. That's all there is to that. If I'm Colorado, I'm bull rushing, shooting gaps, and I'm making Bo Nix be a passing quarterback. He can't beat you for a full game like that. Way that it is. And you're not going to be able to tell me differently. Okay? What about Ohio State, Notre Dame? I think this is Notre Dame's time to shine. They finally have a chance. This is it. I think Estime is the best running back in the NFL. Or pardon me, in college football. I think they have the best offensive line in college football. I think they have one of the best defensive lines in college football. This is their shot. You want to put a beat down on Ohio State, win this thing convincingly, because this is your year. You look at the schedule, you look at the team you got, this is it. This is your one chance. Now, I will say this. I think they have a better coach than Brian Kelly. Now they do. Right? Gave the man a chance. Look what he's doing. There we go. UCLA, Utah, look, on paper, I think UCLA should win that football game. Again, if I'm UCLA, I've got Harden and Steele as my running backs. I'm shoving it down their throat. I'm actually trying to slow this damn thing down because I don't want to keep giving Utah the damn football. That's for damn sure. So Kelly needs to chill out, man. I mean, seriously. It's okay to slow the game down. You don't want to keep giving Utah chances. I like Chip Kelly over Whittingham just because I feel like he's already established his team early enough on in the season without all this other stuff. Again, as of the moment of this broadcast, Utah has not decided on who their quarterback is going to be. And I understand that it's very touch and go with Cam Rising. You have to be careful. You don't want to blow the kid's ride to the NFL. I get that. But at some point, you've got to make a decision, because if they have it, and this isn't all some game that they're playing with UCLA to try and throw them off come Saturday, okay? If this is the real deal, then the way that it is simply this. You are hindering your team by not giving the guy that's supposed to start the reps. Because if he's not getting the reps, then they're not getting in rhythm. And if they're not getting in rhythm, it's going to be really hard to do it on Saturday if they haven't even done it by Thursday. That's all I'm saying. All right, everybody. I am Drew Duncan. Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram is all at Drew Duncan Radio. I am wherever you're listening to podcasts. Simply Tell Your Device to play Fired Up by Drew Duncan. iTunes, iHeart, Google, Spreaker, Deezer. Wherever you're listening, I am there. I am on TikTok and I am on YouTube. Simply look for The Real Drew Duncan. I am brought to you in part by Block 50 Global Radio. Block 50 Global Radio is online on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram, and TikTok as well. Block 50 Global Radio. Block 50 Global Radio is online 24/7, 365 at zenofm.com/Block50 Global Radio. Obviously, tomorrow we're going to be talking about the 49ers-Giants game from tonight. A couple of more college football games to preview and all other news and sports. Your local programming is next, so don't you dare touch that dial.